Welcome to Hydrogeology 101. My name is Andreas de Jong. In today's video, I want to talk about terms of reference and bill of quantities as they would apply to a water well. In a previous video, I talked about my preferred groundwater exploration strategy. The first phase involves a desk study and a baseline survey. We'll go to the field and try to get as much information as we can, and in the office, we try to get together all the data and reports from previous studies. If that is positive, we go ahead with our geophysical survey. This involves a lot of work in the field, and when we're back at the office, we'll do the interpretation. For example, here is our VES curve, and we've modeled a quaternary aquifer, which is our target aquifer. Based on this information, we can decide where we want to drill and also how deep we want to drill. And based on our information, we might also know how much our well yield is likely to be and still determine our casing sizes and consequently also borehole sizes, which will be required for this water well. So now the next phase is the drilling and pumping test phase, which is the most expensive part of the project. We want to drill a water well, which gives us lots of water. But our main question is, how do we select the right contractor? The first thing we do is launch what's called an expression of interest. So we ask, who would like to drill our water well? And we're going to get a lot of responses from different contractors coming back to us, all saying they'd like to bid for this project. But if we have too many contractors expressing an interest in the project, the next thing we need to do is to eliminate a few of them. Otherwise, we're going to end up with a lot of paperwork, not just ourselves, but also these contractors, which is a bit unnecessary. So we've selected our preferred list of contractors. Now we're going to invite them to tender. A tender is a formal offer or a bid to win a contract for a project. These tenders are evaluated by our tender evaluation committee, and we're going to select the winning contractor. To do this, we want to base our decision on quality and cost, not just cost. Don't just pick the cheapest one. You've also got to make sure that they can do the job. So maybe in this case, we'll select company number 3. We're going to make a deal with this company, otherwise known as a contract. They're going to drill our water well. They'll get paid for their work. And all this will be controlled by a bunch of documents. The key documents which are required are, first of all, the standard conditions of contract. Now, these documents here, or usually it's just one big document, is written by the lawyers of your institution or company, so it's not something that we're going to edit. We'll always use this as our basis. And normally, us hydrogeologists will not be involved in this kind of document. What we will be asked to do is to develop the technical terms of reference and also the bill of quantity. So these are the two documents which we're going to talk about today. Let's start with the technical terms of reference, otherwise known as TOR. TOR is a formal document that is used to describe a project, the scope of what needs to be done, the technical standards which needs to be met, and who is responsible for what activities and outputs. TOR create a shared understanding of the project between all stakeholders. So the TOR are a very important document, both during the tendering process, they form an important part of the overall contract, and during project implementation, they form a very important point of reference, especially if there is a dispute. We can always pick up the TOR and look at the relevant paragraph and try to solve any issues that there could be between us and the contractor. Okay, so terms of reference should have an introduction, scope of work, which means what is going to happen in our project, how are we going to select our drill sites, who needs to be present, do we need GPS readings, what kind of drilling methodology is appropriate, do we want rotary drilling, downhole hammer or whatever, how are we going to design the well, how are we going to install the casing and screen, what's the quality of materials that needs to be used? What kind of well alignment test do we need to make sure that later on we don't have a problem to install the pump? How are we going to sterilize the well? What kind of pumping tests need to be carried out? Who's going to take the water samples and what parameters need to be analyzed? What kind of reports are required from the contractor? Who's going to supervise the works? Last but not least, what kind of quality management plan, health and safety and environmental plans are required from the contractor before we can let them come to the project site? Okay, so here's some general remarks. Be as concise and accurate as you can. Make sure that all important background information is included, such as the project scope, methodology, materials, quality, control systems, and so on. Use bullet points where possible. Less is more, as I often say. Keep it as short as possible, preferably no longer than a few pages. Don't copy-paste. If you can, refer to existing standards wherever possible. You don't need to have lots of details in the terms of reference if you can refer to an existing standard. Here's an example of the scope of works for a project that we're going to be doing in Kabul soon. And you can see we've just got a bunch of bullet points here. We're going to drill and install one water well, do some sieve tests, some logging, well development, an airlift pumping test, and construct the wellhead, disinfect the well, carry out some pumping tests, and finally there's going to be a water well drilling and pumping test report. You'll notice that there is no bullet point for a pump house or anything like that, so that's clearly outside of the scope of works. Finally, let's have a look at the Bill of Quantities. Bill of Quantities is a list of all the materials, parts and labor and the associated costs which are required to complete a project. The quantities may be measured as units of lump sum, number, area, volume, weight or time. Think of the BOQ as a complete shopping list of the project. The BOQ are made based on the terms of reference and any design drawings. They're very useful before, during and after construction. Here's an example of a bill of quantity for the water well we discussed earlier. So we have these columns here. The first one is a number, so each item is clearly numbered, a description of what it's about, unit, quantity, the rate per unit, and the total cost. So here in bill number one, we cover mobilization and demobilization. So the first row here is about all the costs associated with coming to the site with all the equipment and personnel and whatever is required. It'll be paid as a lump sum and it's only going to be one of them. So we're not going to mobilize twice to the site. Now, we're only wanting to drill one water well, but it doesn't matter. We have a separate line for setting up at the borehole location. In case we need to drill a second well, then we already have here an item which we can use to cost this move. Okay, I'm not going to list all of the items in the BOQ, just an example. This is from bill number 2 for drilling. We're going to be drilling the first 3 meters at 16 inches. We're going to install some surface casing and then continue open hole at 12 and a quarter inches down to the bottom of the borehole. You'll see that the units here are meters and there's an estimated quantity which of course is not exact. It might change quite a lot in the final outcome of this well. We might stop the well at, for example, 70 meters, so then basically the total here will be based on 70 meters, not 97. For the well completion, we're going to install 8-inch UPVC casing. Again, the quantities are in meters. There's going to be installation of some gravel pack, again quantities in meters, and some neat cement grout in the top 6 meters. The pumping tests are paid per hour. So we have a step test, 4 times 1 hour steps, a constant rate pumping test of 72 hours, and a recovery test here of 24 hours. Finally, there's going to be a report. And you'll see here, item number 6 is the subtotal, so the total of all of the different items above. Then we have our contingency, item number 7. Now here, we can be pretty sure that we're not going to go too much below 100 meters, so it's only about 15%, but this contingency could be higher if we're not so sure. For example, we might have a contingency of 25%. Finally, we should add any government taxes or other costs. which the contractor has to pay, because anyway they're going to charge it onto us. And if this is forgotten, it can be quite a big surprise if there's suddenly some VAT or whatever else appearing at the bottom of our invoice, which we didn't budget for. Now add this all together and we end up with our grand total. Now during tendering, one of the main benefits of the Bill of Quantity is that we have a complete list of everything needed for the project. So we can be sure that all important items have been priced. It enhances transparency and makes it easier to compare the prices of the different contractors. And also we can identify any contractors who are front-loading the costs. That means, for example, that they charge a lot for mobilization and then have very low rates for everything else. That means they can mobilize to site and then just demobilize, not do the project and still be paid. Now, it puts us in a very strong negotiating position because we can look at individual costs and discuss them during contract negotiations, for example, if there's some front-loading going on. During construction, it's easy to identify and price any variations. So if our borehole is not as deep or deeper than what we expected, it's easy to adjust it in the final bill of quantity. We can also prevent the contractors from charging for additional works because basically everything needs to be included in our agreed bill of quantities. It's also easy to identify and calculate cost savings on a project. If we see we're going to go over budget, we might say, okay, we're going to not do 72 hours of pumping tests, maybe we'll just do 24, for example. And it will help us to assess and approve contractors' invoices, which in any case should be based on the bill of quantity. Finally, after construction, it is useful for the final accounting and it gives us very good information for asset management and life cycle estimations. And this is very important. It helps us to plan and budget new projects, because if we have a database of costs for different projects, it gives us an idea of what to expect in projects of similar nature in a similar area. Okay, just to summarize, we need to have a very clear idea in our head of what it is that we want to achieve. Then we need to make a design, even if it's quite rough, of how deep our well is going to be and what kind of materials which we need. We need to write all this up in a document called the Technical Terms of Reference. And finally, everything needs to be listed in the bill of quantity. So all the material which we need, everything that needs to be paid, should be in the bill of quantities. Okay, I hope that you've enjoyed this little video. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, you can leave them in the comments below. I hope to see you on the next video.